Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Alba Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Alba.
Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody, and Merry Christmas to one and all. This is Todd Alba along with our engineer and producer, Mr. Aaron Zommers, on the board. The fantastic Mr. Zommers, welcome in to this special Christmas show edition of the Todd Alba Show. And Christmas a time, Mr. Zommers, for friends, for family, for just good people. And we have a very special guest here in hour number two.
We sure do.
We have Brady Ewing, a special guy in hour number one, someone I've known for a long time from Richland Center. And it's my pleasure to welcome to the program on our special Christmas edition, someone I met over the last year or so, the Vice President of Marketing here at Civic Media. He also is the host of Mad Unity on Wednesday nights right here in Civic Media, better known as Cosmo Brown to his listeners on Wednesday night. It is our one and only Jorge Reyna.
Hello.
How are you doing, Jorge?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Feliz Navidad.
Feliz Navidad a usted también.
Gracias. Mi español es malo, pero más o menos yo entiendo.
Es más o menos.
Sí, gracias. Uh-huh. I'll work on it.
Yeah, you said my name. You spelled it. You pronounced it correctly. So that's good.
Yes, that's the biggest thing.
Roll those R's.
Well, I learned that. I talked about in the first hour of the show. You know, I've spent a couple of Christmases in El Salvador, in Central America, and gave a little background on that. Tell folks, you know, your background a little bit and some of your favorite Christmas memories.
Yeah, so I was born in Guatemala City, and Christmas is a very, you know, it's, like you said, it's like here, it's just family, but mm-hmm. it's also a very solemn occasion because it's, you know, the birth of Jesus and all of the things. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the staple of every Guatemalan household is having a nativity scene.
Right.
Over time, the Christmas tree was added also. Mm-hmm. But really, you know, at least my family would create the nativity scene, but they don't put the baby Jesus in it mm-hmm. until midnight on Christmas Eve, because that's technically, you know, right. We call it Jesus is born.
Right.
And the baby Jesus gets kind of revealed in the nativity scene. So that was always our tradition growing up. It was wait till midnight, then, you know, kneel, pray, and then you exchange the gifts. So, like, as kids, all we really, you know, kind of tended to care about was getting the presents, like, at 12, 10. Right. We'd go through that, like, kneeling, and okay, mom, okay, grandma, that's cool. But, something did stick, I guess.
Right. It doesn't matter whether you grew up in Guatemala, El Salvador, or Wisconsin. Yeah. Kids are kids, right?
Yeah, exactly. You just want the toys, you know. You right. want to see what Santa brought you. But, you know, like food was also a big part of our tradition, and we would, you know, like we make tamales, Guatemalan tamales.
I was curious because El Salvador, when I was there, it was pavo, you know, turkey. It was a big, you know, it was a turkey that had to bake like in an earthen oven all day long. There's kind of like this brown, delicious sauce that went with it.
Yeah, it's probably mole.
Yeah.
So in Guatemala, it's, you know, I mean, tamales are very regional, even though it's a tiny country. But the ones we had, we would call them tamales colorados, which is basically just a corn dough with, you know, chicken or pork or whatever. But the distinct thing in Guatemala is that we wrap them on banana leaves and then they get boiled. It's a whole process. Like to make tamales, like we, at some point, my mom would make them, but mostly you just buy them. You order them for Christmas.
I've seen them made. I mean, you're right. It is a process.
Yeah. It's like, I mean, you know, at the very least, a full 8 to 10 hour day with the whole family, like assembly, you know, from cooking to assembling them. Mm-hmm. But that becomes our, you know, between that and then, like fruit punch, so essentially just a bunch of fruits, like boiled into a punch, basically, just like cooked, you know, and then you drink the juice, and it's just, you know, ponche and tamales. That's the jam.
Sounds delicious.
And then typically it gets a little colder, so it's like the punch is like warm, and then also chocolate, like hot chocolate, but you know, like made for, like, you know, have you seen the Mexican chocolate, la abuelita? It's basically that same thing. It's like sugar and cacao just meshed together and it gets boiled to make a hot chocolatey drink.
You can, if you have not tried it, you can go to any Latin store across Wisconsin. And even some, now many, I'll call them, you know, quote unquote, American grocery stores.
Like Festival Foods might
have
it.
A Latin section.
Yep.
And it's in a little, almost like an octagon shape. It looks like a cupcake, yep. You know.
And it's like container. It's like a yellow box. It has a little grandma.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, yep.
It's not just that you can get those anywhere. It's that you should. It's delicious.
La abuelita. Yeah.
Especially in this weather, this is perfect. To, you know,
a little bit of chill in the air.
Yeah, so. Just a tad bit. You know, like as a tropical bird in Wisconsin, I'm telling you, I'm actually enjoying it. I get to buy like you know my big fancy sport like winter coat, and you know I'm enjoying it. So
and see, so how many winters have you been here?
Well, this is my first one, like full winter. Yeah, and apparently I brought up some of the warmth because it sounds like it's historically low.
This is one of the warmest winters, Christmases I can remember.
I'll take it. You know, ease me into
it. It's all for the global warming.
That's right.
Help me survive.
Oceanfront property in 20 years.
joking.
No, it's a joke. We're kidding. Yeah, please don't hate us.
But we just got to have a little fun during the holidays.
Yep.
Tell folks here, Jorge, as someone who was originally born in Guatemala, and I don't want to get into too much on the political side. We did some of this yesterday. But I think it's just a great time to stop and think that Christmas traditions have evolved over time in this country as new immigrants have come. And, and I see that so much more, whether it's more Latin food products in our grocery stores or whatever. But I see so many, you know, festivals in towns across Wisconsin celebrating some in a slightly different way, celebrating Christmas in more of a Latin theme.
Yeah. You know, I think the big connection throughout, right, is the Christian story
the religious part of
Christmas. So I think that actually was one of the things that helped us assimilate a lot better to be able to, even though when we first came to this country in California, we were kind of basically were helped by a refugee organization that was Methodist, but we were Catholic. Mm-hmm. But at Christmas, you know, they had the nativity scene. And so you could kind of see some of those things reflected. So it just eases you in. And just people are just warmer towards others in the holidays. Right. So that was always like Christmas was a time when we definitely felt more welcome. Like, you know, even though it was California, there's always issues, you know, Prop 8 back in the 90s and all that fun stuff. But the holidays, you know, my mom would that's when we would make tamales. Like when we got here, somehow she found all the ingredients she needed by going to LA and just buying all of these different things. And then we would sell them to people from the congregation that were just love them. So it was my job to stir the dough.
Like nice, really.
Pouring lard. And you know, it was very interesting high school years of me peddling tamales during Christmas. But
isn't that the cool thing, Jorge? And we're talking with Jorge Reyna here, our vice president of marketing at Civic Media. And isn't that one of the fascinating things about Americans is that, you know, no matter our color of our skin, some of these traditions of Christmas, whether it's the more religious story of the nativity or whether it's the secular part of Santa Claus, we're bound together as humans.
Yep.
And we find out we're so much more alike than we are different.
Yeah, and the thing is that it does, you know, whether you subscribe to the religious aspect of it or to the secular aspect, a lot of the times it's both, right? Like, you know, you still like your presents at Christmas. Yeah. It is about just taking the time to reflect about our commonality and how, you know, just the principles of it, you know, like peace on earth, you know, love, et cetera, all the good things. And it's just kind of a hit pause and all the whatever may be troubling you throughout the year. And that's the aspect that I think really resonates with everybody, right?
Yeah, I think it makes it, to me, the greatest holiday of the year because it's celebrated truly around the world.
Yep.
And it's that one moment of the year, right, where it's like, oh, wait, we all are actually pretty alike and we could all actually get along if we try. Why can't we do this the other 364 days of the year?
Right, exactly. And it's funny because we ask it every year, right?
Right.
Just forget. Come to December 26th. No, hopefully we don't forget. But I do think that it's also, you know, it also seems to coincide with a lot of other faiths.
Yeah.
You know, sort of like
holidays. Hanukkah. So you have Kwanzaa. You have other things going on as well.
Yeah, and so that's... It's in the air, I guess, maybe.
Yeah, you know? Absolutely. So tell us a couple minutes here, 3 minutes left in this segment. I talked to El Salvador. I'm not sure. I'm interested in Guatemala. In El Salvador, you know, Christmas Eve has a lot of tenets that we might look at as New Year's Eve here, because in El Salvador, you have a lot of fireworks going off, and it's not necessarily a quiet time of the year.
And so, we always had fireworks, and, you know, some other day I'll tell you a story when I burned my fingers because the firecracker exploded in my hand. But when I went recently back for it's like people, it's like the fireworks display in Guatemala City, the 24th becomes the 25th of midnight. It's impressive. It goes on for at least an hour, and it's just like a spectacle. Like the whole city just erupts in fireworks because it's the celebration that everybody looks forward to.
And in Central America, I think maybe people who have lived in the United States all their lives don't realize the 24th is really the day. Yeah. The 25th is a lot more chill.
Yeah, well, the 25th, you're kind of tired from the 24th because you stayed. And, you know, we bought what we call estrenos, which is like a brand new outfit, like socks, underwear, pants, shirts, everything just brand new. And it's just a way to kind of mark the end, you know, just a renewal, I guess, if you want to put it in religious spiritual terms, but also you get new stuff. So
that's super cool. That's super cool.
Yeah.
Are you sticking around here for the holidays?
Yeah, I'm going to be here for the holidays. Just hanging out with, you know, local friends, you know, Sage and, you know, they're friends of mine. So I will be experiencing the whole Christmas season here. So New Year's. So
we're actually
going to an event in Oshkosh that's sort of a, you know, DJs that are part of the show Mad Unity.
Oh, wow, that's
well,
cool.
Well, we hope to get them here eventually, but they're local Madison DJs that are playing out there. So
there's a whole scene here.
You want
to
come, Aaron?
I don't know if I can, but we'll see.
Yeah. Aaron's produced our show a few times during emergencies.
Yeah.
So
I've come down and seen the scene.
That's right.
It's great people. You can hear it every Wednesday here on Civic Media. It's called Mad Unity. Why the alter ego name of Cosmo Brown? Do you change into a different personality?
I don't really, but it's just historical because I used to DJ under that name in Los Angeles in the 90s. Oh. So
look at Jorge.
we're just keeping that tradition alive.
Jorge Reyna, ladies and gentlemen, he is the Vice President of Marketing, the host of Mad Unity every Wednesday night. Jorge, thanks for taking
the time on short notice.
Yeah, thanks for sharing your experience and your traditions.
And
Merry Christmas to you.
Yes, Feliz Navidad a todos. Merry Christmas.
Gracias, Feliz Navidad a usted, toda su familia en Guatemala y toda la gente también.
Gracias, Todd.
Gracias.
Feliz Navidad, Aaron.
We'll be back in just a minute. Don't go anywhere. It's our special Christmas show on Civic Media's Radio Network.
Awesome.
Welcome back to the Tunnel Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Buenos tardes, la gente. I feel like I'm on La Univision. Sábado Gigante. That was a great show for many years. Ever seen that?
No, I don't think I have.
Oh, my gosh. I used to watch that in El Salvador all the time. Sábado Gigante was a great show. Like a variety show. Kind of like Ed Sullivan meets David Letterman meets The Price is Right. Anyway, it was a great tune. That one goes out to Nelson and all the folks out in Los Angeles.
There you go. Yeah. And he was also dancing along.
He's also dancing along. That's fantastic. Welcome back to our special Christmas show. Thanks, special thanks to Jorge Reyna for joining us there in that last segment. And again, it's just fascinating to hear other people's experiences during the Christmas season, because the more you find out, the more you find out that we're so much more alike than we think.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. So thank you to Jorge. Welcome back to our special Christmas show, whether you're listening live today on Friday, the 22nd of December, or whether you're listening to the tape delayed version on Christmas Day proper on Monday, the 25th of December, where we welcome you in and hope you're enjoying your holiday season, your Christmas season, right here with us.
I know I am. I brought in some hot chocolate and for myself and for Todd.
Yes.
And I used up all the hot water, so Todd didn't get to make it yet. And I also already drank all of mine because I couldn't help myself.
Whoa. I'm enjoying the sip of the powder. So just the fun. I'll put some water with it here. But thank you, Mr. Summers. Appreciate that. People that know me know I love a good beverage, whether it's hot chocolate or a coffee or a Paloma. I enjoy a good beverage. So thank you for that. Appreciate it.
I would have liked to make my own mix or something, but yeah. I brought in what I already had.
Well, yeah, that's the spirit, right? You do with what you have. 22 minutes now past the hour of 1 o'clock on this special Christmas edition. Wanted to take a minute to talk Christmas movies. Christmas movies. Because I'm not sure your household, Mr. Zommers, or anybody else out there, but in our household, we love a good Christmas movie. And I'm going to bring up a controversial one. Well, somewhat controversial. Love Actually, one of my actual favorite movies. And I know I've told this story once before on the air, but I'll tell it one more time because it's fantastic. The first time that I saw Love Actually was with my mom. And people who know this movie are like, what? So mom and I, during the holiday, when this movie first came out, it's like 20 years right now, I think.
Something like that.
So it was during the holiday season, the Christmas season, sometime in December, and we actually were going to go see, and I can't remember what it was, we were going to go see a different movie. That's, we had gone to the theater to see some other movie that came out at the same time. And we're standing in line, and I saw my friend and former roommate, it happens to be Phil Nee's brother-in-law, Ray Brown. And he was with someone, and they were coming out of the movie theater. I hadn't seen Ray in a long time. Oh, my God, Ray Brown. And so I went over and gave him a hug. We started talking. And my mom, in the meantime, stayed in line. And she got up to where you buy the tickets. And she said, what movie is it again? And I just glanced up. But I said, oh, Love Actually. And so we got the wrong movie, you understand, that we had intended to see. And so my mom and I are sitting next to each other. The theater wasn't super packed, but it was kind of full. And the previews come on. And the movie comes on. And this guy's singing, and it's kind of funny. And I'm like, well, I didn't think that was what it's about. And then there's a scene early on in the movie, because the movie follows a series of different people and couples in the UK. It's a British movie. And one of the couples that they follow are these, they're not porn stars. They are the fluffers. They're the people who just are the fill-in while they set the lights and the camera for the actual porn movie.
So they just kind of sit there and go in different poses and they're chatting and they're like, so how are you doing today?
Pretty much. Yeah. And they happen to be naked while they're doing it. And as soon as this came on, my mom and I look at each other and realize this is not the movie that we had intended to see. And my mom is a very cool, chill mom. And she thought this was hilarious. And of course, I thought it was. And so we start laughing. And people are looking at us like, well, okay, it's kind of funny, but it's not that funny. But it was super funny because it was not the movie we had intended to see. And anyway, so we watched the movie and we both said, we're so glad that we picked this movie out of a mistake because it ended up being a fantastic movie.
It is a great movie. It's not explicit like that may make it sound.
No.
It also is not for young children.
Right, it is.
Like, it's rated R, and it does deserve that rating, but it's a great movie. And it did come out in 2003, so yeah, 20 years.
20 years. Well, Mom and I are going to watch it this weekend. I have it on DVD. So yeah, we'll watch it. Yes, that's a good point to make, Mr. Summers. It is not in any way, shape, or form pornographic or anything. It happened, you know, bare-chested and a bare buttock, and that's about all you see.
And then they swear sometimes. That's why
they swear, right. But so yeah, you don't want to watch it, you know, with small children, but, you know, teenagers and above, it's a great movie. It's hilarious. And you know, a lot of big stars in it. A lot of big stars. And of course the big Mariah Carey tune, All I Want for Christmas Is You, not sung by Mariah Carey, but someone else. So I think it's a great, and there's a great message to it as well. Just a great message. So if you are an adult and you have time and you haven't seen it yet, you know, look up Love Actually. It's one of my favorites. Speaking of one of my favorites, have a couple of minutes. Speaking of the UK and Love Actually, a longtime listener, Jay over London, calling in. Jay, as someone who lives in the UK, is Love Actually as popular there as it was here?
Yes, it's popular. You know, you and me, we are the same mom and dad. So I can see you. Since you started talking, I was laughing here in the kitchen.
Well, yeah, you have to be a chill parent, right? And so that's great.
Indeed, my brother. Well, how are you guys?
Merry Christmas, Jay, to you and yours. Are you doing anything special to celebrate the holiday over there across the pond?
I will be in the house cooking. I wish I'm in the United States and I call you guys to come and eat food. Oh, my goodness. I love my brothers.
Well, that would be fantastic. I'm only sorry that we don't live closer.
Todd, I'll be cooking for you whenever I come to the United States. I'll be cooking for you and Aaron, I swear. Right.
We look forward to that. Jay, thanks for weighing in. Appreciate your perspective. And Merry Christmas. Happy holidays to all of you across the pond in the UK. Have a lovely, lovely holiday
season.
Say
hello to mom, okay?
All right. Thank you, Jay.
Say hello to mom.
I will. Thank you, Jay. There you go. An actual UK citizen checking in on Love Actually, stamped and approved by a UK citizen.
Excellent. Excellent. Yeah.
Any particular Christmas movie for you, Mr. Zomers?
Well, I do love that one. I also, anybody who is a good friend of mine knows that I love the worst movies, like just terrible, terrible movies. They're so bad, they're good. Uh-huh. And one of my favorite Christmas movies, that's only barely a Christmas movie. This one, again, is not for children. It is Silent Night, Deadly Night, Part 2.
Oh, for goodness sake. Are you serious?
It is one of the worst movies I've ever seen.
That's just a horror movie guised as a Christmas movie.
I guess it's technically a horror movie. There's no jump scares or anything. It's just terrible. It's so funny. It's just a comedy movie. It's only barely a Christmas movie.
Only barely.
I know I'm going to watch it tonight, which is why I brought it up.
Die Hard, a Christmas movie or not?
I think whatever you believe.
Oh, you chickened out. The correct answer is yes. Die Hard is a Christmas movie. Yeah. Yes, that's the correct answer. All right, back with more on the other side, more Christmas tunes, our special Christmas show on the Civic Media Radio Network. Christmas show on the Tolerable Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. 36 minutes now past the hour of 1 o'clock. If that doesn't get you up and dancing, Mariah, or as her ex-husband likes to call her, Mariah Carey, a little All I Want for Christmas Is You.
That song is everywhere.
It's everywhere, just like our very own news director, Terry Bell, goodness. Is everywhere. Terry, thanks for popping in for a second.
Well, sure. Merry Christmas, Todd.
Merry Christmas to you. How are you doing?
I'm doing well, doing well. Everybody's getting ready for the big holiday.
I know.
The news never stops, so we're just going to keep an eye on things for a few more hours and then take the foot off the pedal just a little bit.
Yeah. Well, you and I are kind of from the same neck of the woods in southwest Wisconsin.
Yes.
Are you getting back to the old Driftless for a bit?
The family is gathering in the beautiful Driftless region in Gays Mills. So that'll be a very nice weekend. Seeing some friends that are far-flung, too, who are back in the hometown for the weekend. Yeah.
Any particular Christmas traditions, foods, drinks that that your family celebrates?
Oh, sure. This is a common one. We're going to partake at some point this weekend, oyster stew.
Oh.
Yes.
Absolutely. Now, see, that's one that our family never got into, but I recently tried it when I was out in Seattle visiting one of my godsons.
Oh, Seattle.
And I'm like, wow, why haven't I had this before?
Yeah, it's amazing. It's an acquired taste. It's kind of a rite of passage, too. You kind of reach that point, I don't know, in middle school or high school when you work up the courage to try it for the first time, because oysters, and not exactly as delicious as they are, don't have a lot of aesthetic appeal.
Right.
Especially if you're, you know, 12.
What, if it's prepared right,
it's absolutely delicious. And if you like seafood, you like oyster stew. And I took right to it, and I felt like a grown up the first time because there were alternatives to oyster stew at the family gathering. For those who were a little too squeamish or just didn't like fish, but boy, once I had it, I was hooked.
Yeah, well, that's fantastic. Oh, it's a great time of year for those things that you don't have. I don't think there's nothing wrong with having a food that you set aside to have once or twice a year because that just makes it more unique and special.
I feel that same way too. I also like, speaking of seafood around the holidays, I love pickled herring.
Really?
Yes.
Now that one I haven't had.
Oh, you're missing out. It is so good. But I tell you, I have it exactly 2 days a year. Uh-huh. And as much as I love it, that scratches that itch just fine.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. A poll we're doing here in the office. Mm-hmm. Die Hard, Christmas movie or no?
I'm on the fence on this one. It takes place on Christmas, doesn't it? Yeah, it's kind of hard. You know, I'll say yes, since people seem to be caught up in the spirit. Yes. I will say then, Hard's a Christmas movie, then The Apartment is a Christmas movie.
I've never seen it.
Billy Wilder. About 1960 or so.
Really?
Jack Lemmon, Shirley MacLaine. Oh, wow. It's a classic.
Maybe I don't think I have. Mm. But, well, all right, maybe I'll dial that up this weekend.
Okay, but it's about, at the end, a couple of singletons and the holidays and the choices they have to make at a time of year, which can be lonely for a lot of folks.
And we very well said. We talked about that at the top of the show. For those that might be home because of illness or what have you, I've been there. It's not fun, but that's why we're here. And you know, you have some programming all through the holidays. And again, just in all seriousness, if you're having particular depression or really struggling, just dial 988, the crisis hotline for mental health and suicide prevention. 988, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, even on this Christmas holiday. So be aware of that. Great reminder, Terry.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I'm thankful for your friendship. Thankful as your colleague here. Thanks for all you've done for Civic over the last year or so. And look forward to a very busy and exciting 2024.
It's going to be a very busy 2024. We should just enjoy a couple of days of a fairly relaxed pace because it's going to pick right up after the first of the year.
Absolutely. Terry Bell, News Director for Civic Media. Thanks for popping on short notice. We appreciate it. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Terry Bell, great to have him along with us and all of our other folks as well. I think now 20 minutes before the hour of 1 o'clock. What do you think, Mr. Zomer? Should we go into a little extended board game of the week? Are you ready for that?
Sure, we could do that.
All right, time now for a holiday edition of Board Game of the Week.
Ho, ho, Merry Christmas.
We have a little holiday special board game of the week where I'm not giving you one, I'm not giving you two, I'll give you three board games.
Whoa, a three board game week here on a very fantastic.
However, some of them are games I have done before.
All right, well, that's fine.
But the reason I'm returning is to these games, I'm revisiting these games, is because these are all really good ones for holidays.
All right.
So on the holidays, for me, as a board gamer, as an avid board gamer, there are some games that you only break out with other avid board gamers. Maybe they're really complicated. Maybe they take a long time. Maybe there's just a lot of little pieces.
Sure.
When you have all the five-year-olds running around the house and everything, you got to get something that everyone can play.
Exactly.
And so games that are simple, are colorful, and easy to grasp and can support a lot of players are the best way to go.
All right.
Or that you can easily be on teams. So the first one, I'm going to go back to one of my all-time favorites, exploding kittens.
There are no actual kittens involved.
There are not.
All right, very good.
So in exploding kittens, it's a nice party game, pretty simple, and ultimately it flips most card games on their head, because normally on a card game, you draw a card and then you do whatever you do in the game.
Sure.
In this one, you play as many cards as you want and then draw a card.
Oh.
Because the way you win is by not dying. You die when you draw an exploding kitten because it explodes. It blows you up.
Right.
So yeah, don't mess with exploding kittens in real life either. And you have some cards that you can rearrange cards in the deck. You can move stuff from the top to the bottom. You can shuffle. You can skip your turn. And you can prevent other people from doing those things. And ultimately, your goal is to try and fix the odds in your favor that you don't draw an exploding kitten unprepared. Because once you do, you're eliminated.
All right. Exploding kittens, our first board game of the week. Number two.
Number two, we have Racco. Now, Racco is an old classic from Milton Bradley. I think in the 55 or something like that it came out originally.
Really? Well, okay.
This one's a lot less colorful, but I like it for even younger kids than Exploding Kittens because you have a little rack in front of you. You get dealt cards numbered from 1 to 60. You don't get all of them. You get randomly dealt. And whatever order they're in on your rack is the order they're in.
All right.
And on your turn, you can draw a card or you can steal cards, and you're trying to get them arranged from lowest to highest number on your rack.
All right.
Pretty simple. And so it's good to teach little kids how to play games. I know for me, my sister's children would always see us playing board games and want to join in. And so that was when I broke out, and you'd be on a team with somebody and they're like, I don't know what to do. I don't know the rules. And we're like, well, just look at these numbers. See what order they're in. Is 23 bigger than 50? They're like, no, exactly. All right. So then we know those shouldn't be in that order. And it's a really easy thing to start getting kids to think about rules.
That's fantastic. I really like that a lot, actually.
And it's available pretty cheaply and should be at most stores, I would think. Exploding Kittens is also very popular, so you can find that pretty much anywhere.
All right.
And the last one, those are both card games. And if you're a family that wants to have a board game, like you want to have fun, colorful pieces and a little bit extra setup, Ticket to Ride is a fantastic game.
Ticket to Ride.
That game you can also find pretty much anywhere, not just game stores anymore. And it is about establishing being a railroad tycoon. You know, you have all these railroad paths across a map of the base model is the United States, but you can get all kinds of countries now. And you get train cards to be able to build long train tracks. You get points for how long they are, and you have your own set of private goals. Like maybe mine, I need to build a train from New York City to, I don't know, Miami or something. And if you get that, you get extra points. And so sometimes you can block other people off intentionally or unintentionally. But
we don't want fisticuffs during the holiday season, Mr. Somers.
And I don't think Ticket to Ride will lead to fisticuffs. It's one of those games where I do like cooperative games for family, but it's one of those that's competitive, but it's not aggressive.
All right. Well, that's fair. Competitive, but not aggressive. All right.
Another important aspect of all of these games is they're not just good for kids. They're good for older people. If they don't have great hand dexterity,
or they
need a little extra time to think about something, none of them rely on time, and none of them have tons of little pieces. Okay. So I think there's three very accessible games that are easy to play and a lot of fun for families.
Nice. There you go. There's your board game, your holiday edition of Board Game of the Week. Fantastic. I appreciate that. And the holidays are a perfect time to enjoy a board game, whether it's around a fire or just around the kitchen table, whatever.
Not too close to the fire.
No, we don't want it to be too close to the fire. That's exactly right. But it's a great time of year just to chill out and do that.
I know I will be.
Any Christmas songs that we haven't gotten to today, Mr. Zomers, that you're particularly wanting to talk about today?
Let's see. What are my favorite Christmas songs?
Yeah.
I really do love that Peanuts album, the Vince Guaraldi.
Well, why don't we, I sent you a cut of the Linus speech there, and let's play that. And if there's time left after the speech, we'll play a little bit more of the Vince Guaraldi, Charlie Brown Christmas to take us out into the next break here. But yeah, the Christmas story as told by Linus on penis. Remember, when this was made, Charles Schultz used actual kids as the actor. And I think that's what makes this for me.
Me too.
And towards the end of Charlie Brown Christmas, Charlie Brown is frustrated over the commercialism. And he asks the question at the Christmas play rehearsal, "Can anybody tell me what Christmas is really about?" And then the fantastic Linus goes to center stage and he says this.
"I guess you were right, Linus. I shouldn't have picked this little tree. Everything I do turns into a disaster. I guess I really don't know what Christmas is all about. Isn't there anyone who knows what Christmas is all about?"
"Sure, Charlie Brown. I can tell you what Christmas is all about."
Linus walks to center stage.
"And there were in the same country shepherds, abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night, and lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men."
Then he says, "That's what Christmas is all about, Charlie Brown." So there you go. I think it's a great reminder of what Christmas, the spirit of Christmas. Taking us to break, Mr. Zomers, a little Vince Guaraldi, a little Charlie Brown Christmas, if you'd be so very kind. We'll be back with a little Darlene Love to round out things, David Letterman style, here on a Civic Media edition, a special Christmas edition.
Try to do this every now and then. And now, ladies and gentlemen, performing her holiday classic for us, our good dear friend, Darlene Love.
Welcome back to the Tunnel Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, our special Christmas edition. We'll play more Darlene Love on the way out. Welcome back, Mr. Zomers on the board. Now, 8 minutes before the hour of 2 o'clock, at the top of the hour, our good friend and colleague, Matt Flynn, of Matt Flynn Direct, in with another fine program, whether you're listening on this Friday, December 22nd, or our special replay edition coming up on Christmas Day. So that's coming up as well. So we welcome you back into the show. That's a song, Mr. Zomers. It's a great tradition where Darlene Love used to come on The Late Show with David Letterman. First it was Late Night and then The Late Show. And they reunited on the YouTube special coming up here they had it on YouTube. And Letterman and Paul Schaefer, a longtime band director, and Darlene Love got together along with Barbara Gaines, one of his longtime producers, and they told this story that Darlene Love was really kind of, she had been with a group before and never really got a lot of traction. And once Letterman started having her on The Late Show and started singing this, it was always done the last full show before they took their Christmas break. And it started just with her and Paul at the keyboard and a couple of guys in their original World's Most Dangerous Band. And then by the final, in 2014, the final year that Letterman was on, they had a full orchestra, a full group of background singers, and they stood up on the piano. Darlene Love was on top of the piano. There was snow coming down. It was absolutely fantastic and just a great way to celebrate the holidays. So we're going to play Darlene Love on the way out as well here at the top of the hour. Just did you ever see that live, Mr. Sommers?
I did not.
Yeah, it's as a Letterman fan, I'm sure Mr. Perry, our ongoing contributor, saw that.
I'm sure he has it on tape.
I'm sure he has it on tape. So probably several versions. It is now just a few minutes before the top of the hour. I want to take a minute here. We have a couple of shows coming up on Christmas Day. We are replaying this show. Then on Tuesday, we're going to be replaying our great salute to the Wisconsin Air National Guard with General May and his guests as well. That'll be a great show to listen to on Tuesday. Wednesday, we have a brand new show live from Richland Center next Wednesday. We're going to have Betty Hayes Baxter, who is 93, still teaching dance and just became certified by the Guinness Book of World Records as the longest dance teacher in world history. So she's going to be there live at Richland Center, along with her daughter, Cheryl Baxter, who in her own right is a fantastically wonderful and famous dance teacher. And then Cheryl's son, Ellington Ratliff, is going to join us via internet. And he was part of the great band, the Disney band, R5. So three generations, they're going to have that. We're going to have that live in hour number two from Richland Center on Wednesday. On Thursday, we're going to have a best of. And then Friday, I believe we're going to be live from Green Bay to end out the year on the 29th.
So a lot going on.
A lot going on over the holidays. So hopefully you'll join us all of the rest of the week here on the Todd Allball Show. Some great stuff, whether it's live or whether it's some best of episodes. Mr. Sommers, you've come to that time once again. What you're grateful for on this Christmas special, anything in particular come to your mind?
Well, first of all, in the background, we got a music request from Joanne Kruatz to play the Bing Crosby and David Bowie version of Little Drummer Boy.
Right,
so I'll just play that a little bit while we're talking about this.
All right,
this.
Very good. Anything in particular of thankfulness?
Well, I know we've said it before, and I know we just had the 1-year anniversary of the show last month, but I really am thankful for the opportunity I've had here at Civic Media, and I'm thankful to keep getting to know you and spend all this time together, and it's been a lot of fun.
It has been. We're looking for a lot more in 2024. The feelings are mutual. Many thanks to our founder, our owner, our CEO, Sage Weil, for putting Civic Media together. All these great stations, all these great shows across the Civic Media Radio family. Certainly thankful for you, Mr. Sommers, all your hard work. Thank you so very much for doing that. And also to everybody else at Civic Media who makes this thing run, whether it's Luke Mathers, our executive producer, Terry Bell, our friend Kristen Bry, host of As Goes Wisconsin, all the hosts. We really appreciate each and every one of you. Thankful for my family. Thank you. Thankful for being together with family and friends over the holiday season as well. So, Mr. Sommers, as we say on Fridays once in a while, it's Mimosa Friday. Who lives like we do?
We do.
Merry Christmas, everyone, and happy holidays to each one of you and yours. We're going to take it out with a little bit more Darlene Love, because that's what Christmas is all about, right? Just being music, friends, family. We'll see you later on this week. Thank you so very much. Matt Flynn is next. On behalf of Mr. Sommers and all of our guests, all of our great people here at Civic Media, Merry Christmas, everybody. Happy holidays to each and every one of you. Here now, Darlene Love, taking us to our friend, Matt Flynn. Keep banging your drum. Yeah. that's fantastic.
I'm in love, ladies and gentlemen. Paul Schaefer. Thank you, everybody.
You can't do better than that, right? If you can't have him on this show, you can't do better than that, Mr. Zombie.
Definitely not. And she's not done yet, though.
Oh, all right. Very good. A little bit more.